Hi there. My name is Bernie Hogan, and I'm a senior research fellow at the University of Oxford. I'm a member of the Network Canvas team, and today I'd like to talk to you about Network Canvas Interviewer. As you may know, if you're familiar with the Network Canvas suite of apps, there's three, at least three right now. Network Canvas Interviewer is the main one where you would conduct an interview with a respondent or a survey participant. The other two apps, Architect, are for, Architect is for building the sort of protocols that you would run in Interviewer. And then Server is a program that we can use for managing interviews on multiple field devices or, you know, multiple interviews across different time periods and stuff where you want to merge them together. But most of the heavy lifting in research will be through the actual interviewer itself, going out and interviewing people, collecting that network data. So it's really useful to be familiar with how Interviewer works, maybe look under the hood at some of the ways in which you can make the interviewer experience a little more appealing or comfortable for the respondent. And then to think about different strategies for data collection, because there are different ways in which to collect the same sort of data. We'll show some of them here, and also help you think about what strategies are going to work best for your own research. So this walkthrough today has two parts, and the first part is just getting oriented to Network Canvas, and we'll be using a protocol for that, which you can find in the description for this video down below. Then the second part is going to be a walkthrough of different styles of collecting data, and we'll be using a protocol that's down in the description. That's protocol number two, and that'll be Alter Demo 2. You can use that for that. Without further ado, let's get started and have a look at Network Canvas itself. If you've never opened Network Canvas before or never loaded a protocol into Network Canvas, you'll see three sections right here. The top one is Network Canvas Interviewer, sort of the welcome screen. You can turn that off if you like, but I tend to like to keep it on, actually. Down here is protocols, and this is how we would load new protocols. And then finally we have server status. Now you see here it says no servers found, and that's because I'm not running a copy of Network Canvas server on my local network, nor have I already paired with another server. We're not going to be worrying about that. We're going to export the data directly from the Network Canvas Interviewer app itself. Before we even get into the actual application into a protocol, I first want to have a look here at the settings, and in particular, the display settings. The visual preferences right here. The reason is because depending on the type of setup of your computer, Windows, Mac, or Linux, or even if you're doing this on an iPad or a Chromebook, the text might be a bit small or large. So we can go ahead and change the text slightly. I'm actually going to, for the sake of this video, I'm going to bring it all the way up to 115. And we're running this in full screen. The rest of this is not going to be too important for us now. But the full screen forms are useful if you're running this on an iPad or another device. If you're going to use a form with a keyboard, it pops up a virtual keyboard to the bottom of the screen. And when it does that, that can actually be a bit of... it can make it really hard to see a lot of the forms. So that's what full screen forms are for in that context. And we'll have a look at some of the other settings later on when they come up. But this is, you know, we just want to check the interface scale here. Okay, so now we have a couple options for how you would load in a protocol from a URL. So indeed, you can download one directly from the web if you have a URL for that. And then you can also import from a file. I have the file locally on my computer here right now, but the same files will be available in the description of this video below and on the Network Canvas site. So the first one here is Workshop Protocol 1. It's called SB21 Workshop because this was originally for the 2021 Sunbelt International Social Network Analysis Conference. And so we ran a workshop there, and this is we're going to walk through that, you know, here today pretty much in the same way. So I load up that that protocol, and you can see here in the bottom gives us a little pop-up saying it's installed successfully, so that's good. So we're just going to clear that. And now a new section has appeared. It says start a new interview. So I'm going to go start that new interview down below, and I'm going to give it the name SB Demo 001. You can name it in any way you like, But I do want to caution you if you're in a multi-device environment. In a multi-device environment, it's really hard for us to confirm that the case ID on one device is not different from the case ID on a different device. So we want to trust you to manage those case IDs as being different. On the other hand, though, we will append a specific session ID, which is a really long string of characters. So there's never going to be a time when this one's going to sort of overwrite another file. We're going to make sure that even if you give them the same names, they're going to be different files. But it is useful for your own management to have case IDs that are distinct and ensure that they stay that way. Okay, so I'm going to start that interview here. Now you can see in the we've now started the interview. This is where you would first begin with the participant. And you see here we have a splash screen. This is what's called an information screen in Network Canvas and a Network Canvas Architect, or an information stage. If we look over on the side here, we have a couple user elements. We have this button right here, which is not useful, it's not grayed, or it's grayed out because that's the back button and there's nowhere to go back to. But if we see here down below, this is where we go forward. So the interview progresses from the top and goes to the bottom. So if we go down, we can see the next screen, and then we can go back up to get there. And so this is a way in which you can navigate the interview with the interviewee. You can also see here these three horizontal lines, or the burger icon, is often called, now becomes the settings. You see we have an interview duration, and there's no nodes or edges in this interview right now, meaning that we haven't created any yet, but we'll see some now in a minute. Here we can see device settings, which are actually the same settings that we saw previously, but they're now inside the interview for us. And we can also see from there interview stages. So if I click on that, you'll see the stages of the interview. And actually, there's not very many. We only got six stages. They kind of have this like London Metro style sort of linear flow to them this way. But of course, we put this here so that you don't have to do it in a linear flow if your particular interview style involves you going back and forth. And that often happens when people remember new names of other people that they want to add to the network that they have. So being able to navigate this in a comfortable way with the interviewee, moving through these things, is really helpful. Now, I did get there through this way, but just to show you, you can actually also click on the progress bar itself and get there. So we were right at the beginning. Here we are. On an interview stage, you can put on images, you can put on video, audio, or text. And in this case, this is an image right here, and that's just some text that we've typed in. Now to begin, let's have a look at the first question. So think about the people that you know. Who do you feel close to or discuss important matters with? So this is a classic question in sociological research, the discuss important matters question, and featured in the General Social Survey and some publications based on them. Now, in order to add someone here, I'm going to use this button as a plus, and this is a person right here, or a person icon. So I click on them. So the first person I'm going to nominate is Michelle Burkett. She's the PI on the Network Canvas project, and followed by Josh for Josh Melville. And here's some other members of the team. Gregory, also a PI. Pat, who's working on the project as an epidemiologist, and I can't forget the lab manager, Kate Banner. And Kate really is the glue keeping us all together. Okay, so now we have our five members of the team, or five nodes, that I'm going to use for the rest of the interview. If nodes available, then we can progress on to the next stage. But first, I just wanted to show off something here just in case. You make a mistake, or the interviewee makes a mistake. For example, let's say I add another name. Maybe I add me, not realizing that it's supposed to just be other people that we talk to, and not myself. So perhaps I can drag this and drop that into the bin. You see the bin here appears at the bottom when you drag on a node, and that works whether it's on a touch screen or using a mouse. So now we have these, we can progress on to the next stage of the interview. Okay, so now in a classic social network sociogram style piece of research, once we have these names, then we can think about how we want to arrange them. At the moment, we're not using any automated layouts. Automated layouts are coming for Network Canvas soon, actually. But we tend to prefer that we find ways for the participant to lay out the nodes themselves. You get some information about the person's cognitive map that way, but you also give them a sense of empowerment over the interview. You feel like you're not just projecting their nodes. You're letting them co-create a network object. Okay, so we have five nodes here. I'm going to put them sort of all equally around this ring, but, you know, the respondents or yourself, if you're doing this, might, you know, arrange them a little differently. Now, you notice down here in the corner, we have three dots right here. This is the first one. These right here, these dots are referred to as prompts. There's a number of places in Network Canvas where we can use a prompt. The screen up here, we can also have multiple prompts on the Network Canvas sort of name generator page. So you can say, think about the people you're close to, or you might have another question, who do you get advice from? But we just had one prompt there, so we don't see the dots. Here we have three. So just watch what happens when I go next. We're not going to advance to the next stage. We're going to advance to the next prompt. All right, so it says here, connect any two people that would spend time together without you being there. Now, we wanted to make the interaction for signaling an edge here something that is easy for the participant to do. And went through a number of different trials, and we are most happy with this at the moment. You click on one node, and then you click on another node. You can see this is a focal node right here. It's kind of bouncing, suggesting it's kind of waiting for something. And then we can click on another node. You can do this. And let's say you accidentally create a link that you don't want there to be. You can sort of just double tap it again, and then it will disappear. It's worth noting that in the program itself, under the hood, the first node that you click is given the from position, and this is the second node is given the to position. So if we have the two nodes for any edge, in this case it would have been Michelle was node one and Kate was node two for that edge. We don't, strictly speaking, have directed networks in Network Canvas at the moment, but that's worth knowing how it's going to show up in the data when we see the data later. Now, select any family members in your network. This is an example of a question that we might do as a sort of a Boolean with a whole network at once. Now, there's one kind of trick with this question in that you can only get the certainty of a positive response. If I click on this person right here, I say Josh's family, then we know that's true, but we don't know that these are necessarily false because we haven't denoted yes, no, or unsure, something like that. So just be mindful of that if you're using this as an entry for that type of question. Now I'm going to select everybody, say they're all part of my Network Canvas family. You can tap on all of them. Well, if I tap again here, then we say Pat's not in the family. No, of course he is. We're all part of the Network Canvas team here. Okay, so now we have another style of question. This is what we might call a name interpreter question. This is where we interpret things about that individual or set of individuals. How often do you communicate with each of the people? And we'll say, weekly, monthly, maybe. I'll just put them all in weekly. So now here is an example of what we would call an ego form. In network analysis, it's often convention to use the term ego, EGO, to mean the respondent or the focal node for a network. And then we use the term alter to refer to all of the other people in the network. So the people that we saw up here, they would all be considered alters, and in this case, I would be considered ego. So, you know, what's your full name? My full name is, close enough. Let's say Bernie Hogan. And my date of birth, well, let's just say I was born yesterday. And so we're recording this today on the 12th. Check that out. I was born today. I was born yesterday. How did I hear about Network Canvas? I helped create it. I mean, in some senses I did, but I really think that the dev team do most of the heavy lifting here. How much do I enjoy attending online workshops? I'm like, well, it's okay. So it says here at the bottom, see this is pulsing right here. Now that's the end of this particular section, this ego form. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's the end of the interview. Although, as it happens, it is the end of the interview. It's the last stage. As we can see here, we go down here, finish interview. So it says, you've reached the end of the interview. If you're satisfied, you may finish the interview now, and I'll press and go finish. So what's going to happen then once we've got that done? Well, we have the data. It's stored in Network Canvas Interviewer. We can see it right here. That interviewer object is represented by this card. Now, this card right here, it has a date when it started. So you can see I'm doing this in on a Thursday evening. And it's not yet exported. Now, if we want to go resume that, imagine cases where you're doing interviews over multiple sessions, or you may want to go back and iterate something for some creative reason, then you can click on Resume Last Interview, and it will take you to the last stage that you were on. So, of course, we're right here on the finish stage, but just watch what happens if I go to the sociogram and say we have to leave, exit the interview. Well, by the way, you can see now we have nodes, we have five of them, and there are four edges of the friend kind of edge. And we only have person nodes, and we only have friend edges. But, you know, your study might get more complicated than that with different kinds of nodes and different kind of connections between them. So now if I exit it from there, I go back, it shows that's where I am right here. That's how it assesses the progress. Also, you can see that progress on the actual card down here. So you'll see it says it's at 50%. But really, the interview is done because we went through the finished interview and got all the data. So I'm going to go down here and look at this new panel, Export and Manage Interview Data, or rather this new section. Select one or more interview sessions by tapping them and then delete or export using the buttons provided. Now, we only have one session, but I can show a second one by starting SP_demo02. And this one's going to be pretty empty because I'm going to go... going to go all the way down to finish interview and then press finish. Okay, so we now have two here. Once we have two sessions, you see here, S002 and then select other interview. I can go down here and it gives me a list of all the interviews. You'll notice that the interviews don't have to be from one single protocol. In this case, it was from one protocol, Workshop Protocol 1. But in a minute, we're going to add a new protocol for Workshop 2 and that'll be available here as well. I am not going to resume either of them. I just wanted to show you that. Those are also available here for the export and interview managed data. We can sort by last changed, top to bottom, case ID. There we can see here, 001, 002, and progress, etc. Okay, so I just really want to export the one that we actually did some real data on. And then I'm going to export selected to files. Watch what happens when I do that. And I'm going to say iteration one. The reason why I wanted to say iteration one is I wanted to show you something here. Something's going to be missing. If I double click and export that right here, date modified today, you'll see it only exported this one file here, SB demo 001. And then it has the case ID, the really long series of numbers there. That keeps it nice and unique. And that's a GraphML file. Now, a GraphML file is useful in a lot of different kinds of graphing programs. Gephi is one notable example where you can load this up and see it. Here's what a GraphML file looks like. It's XML. So you'll see it has these keys that give you the names of the variables and their labels. So this is a long variable name, and this is a long variable label or call AT. It's the attribute, it's the name. So we can see here also some other data. It's really, this is mainly machine for machine readable, but we've got our nodes and we've got our edges. But now more importantly, I want to show you that GraphML is not the only way to use to export this data. And particularly in this case, I want to see it exported in a file that has comma separated values. Now, how would I do that? Well, actually, we'll go up here into settings. And here, have a look at our data export options. So we can export GraphML files, but now let's also export CSV files. You'll notice that we can also merge sessions. Now you read that, if you're merging sessions will cause me to merge into a single file on a per protocol basis. So every one of the cases for this protocol will be all merged into a single file. That's really handy if you have a lot of EgoNets and you don't want to do the wrangling yourself, and this will all stack them one over the other in these CSV files. But we're just going to have a look at one CSV file, or rather, one case. And you'll see that the one case will generate three different CSV files. So it's already been exported, but we're going to export it again. Once we export it, we zip it up and then let's see, it's okay, generation two. If I double click on this, see, it doesn't, in this case now it's got multiple files in there. So in my program, what it's done here is just created that folder. Now let's have a look at the ones that are in here. We have demo 001, and you can see it's got this really long session ID, then attribute list person, edge list friends, and ego, along with the GraphML. So now what do these mean? Well, first of all, this right here is, that's the session ID right here. And then we have attribute list and then person. Why attribute list person? Remember that we had, if we go in, I'll just resume that interview. Okay, so obviously these are all nodes, but why are they person? Because that's the type of node in this particular study. So if we had different kinds of nodes, they'd have their own rectangular CSV. And that's because we would have different variables for different nodes. Let's see what variables we have for the person node. So I'm going to go there. I'm just going to quick look that real briefly. You can see what we have here. And this is just a CSV file, node ID, the UUID, which is sort of unique or universal user ID, I believe, is the what it stands for. And for the ego, and then for the alter. Now, why do we have one for ego and one for alter? Well, because we want to make sure that each one of these alters is linked to the same respondent, in this case, me. If we had merged this in with two people, then we would see perhaps two ego IDs, and we would see then, again, still lots of individual alter IDs. Now, the alter IDs, we also have a name. But of course, this is really useful right here, because sometimes you might have people with the same name, but they actually represent different people. We have a variable here representing the communication frequency. We have some layout variables. Those represent the coordinates for the X and Y coordinates for that sociogram. We just had the one sociogram, so we call the layout variable layout. But you can actually have multiple layouts and give them different names. Maybe you might want a layout where you put the nodes into different coordinates. In which case, knowing which ones are above and below 0.5, for X and Y can tell you, which coordinate they're in, and then you can like do something meaningful with that. Then remember, we also had this Boolean where I said, family member or not, and because I clicked yes on everyone, it has true there for everyone. So that's how this looks when I look at it in preview. You can see it if I double click in Excel or numbers. So there's default there. If I go into Excel, it shows up like a table like so. Okay, I'm not going to save that or do anything with it at the moment. I just wanted to show that to you. We have the same thing here for the friends. We have, once I mentioned, the from and the to. Canvas ID, network canvas ID, source ID. All right, now how would you link these up to that? Well, they're the same as these right here. The node ID is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And down here, we go from 1 to 2. So whatever that would be, Michelle to Josh. And then, from 3 to 5, that would be, from Kate to Gregory, and so forth and so forth. And that's that CSV for the edges. And finally, there's a CSV for ego. Remember, we had an ego form. And in that ego form, We had variables like date of birth and name. But additionally, we also have variables that just refer to the session itself or to the interview itself. And so those go in the ego level data as well. So we can see here the Network Canvas ego UUID. Again, that's useful for merging across the different CSVs. Network Canvas case ID, if you might remember, SB, and it's also up there. Session ID, it's start and finish and exported. And that gives us just some information. Maybe you want to record how long they take and so forth. Exported, full name, date of birth, heard about it. Enjoy conferences. You saw the conferences one had a little slider that we could go from not at all to it's really great, and I put it in the middle. That's what's referred to as a VAS or visual analog scale. It's, strictly speaking, it's not analog, but you do have a lot of precision here in that it goes, from 1,000th to one. Now, where can you use those CSVs? There is a program in R called EgoR, which is a package for doing egocentric analysis, and in our own workshops and workshop videos, you'll see examples of being able to load up some of this kind of data and then do some simple analysis with it later on. Now, before I move on to the next session, I just wanted to show one little detail here about these attribute lists. As you can see here, communication frequency I gave as a 2 for all of them. But what, if you might recall, on the on this wasn't a 2, it was daily, weekly, monthly, and less than monthly. Well, if you open up the workshop protocol into Architect, and just as a little tip here, if you have the workshop file, or sorry, the protocol file available, a .NET Canvas file, you double click on it, it'll open that in Architect, not in Network Canvas Interviewer. But that's okay, because that's what we actually want this time. Now I'm going to, oh, I should have updated my network canvas. Gosh, I'll do that right after this video. Let's see what we can have here. We go down to this ordinal bin. This is the ordinal bin that we did. It says, how often do you communicate with each of the people that you named? That's a prompt. We just had the one prompt. And if I click on it, we look down in here and we can see a label and a value. So the label, daily, weekly, monthly, and less than monthly, and the value themselves are the numbers that are recorded right here. In this case, we also showed a -1 value for the last, and that actually translates over here to this sort of darkest or black, almost black sort of shading, whereas the others have this sort of gradient shading that represents, how ordinal is kind of like a rank order. If we did a categorical, it would actually be they would be separate and they would have unique colors. And we can see that sort of thing in perhaps other videos or I believe in the next protocol. For the second part of this walkthrough, we'd like to go through a protocol that shows different ways in which you can collect data through Network Canvas. The idea behind this is to give you a sense of the perhaps the art of interviewing in Network Canvas. Now, in a workshop setting itself, we might do this as a standalone exercise, but as a video, I'm going to go and talk through each of these ways and kind of do this protocol with you. The protocol itself, as an example for each case, I'm going to use the characters from the Simpsons family, the television show The Simpsons. And to refresh, the Simpsons family, they have 5 members. Marge, Homer, Bart, Lisa, and Maggie, all at least living in the household. Although, of course, on the show, there's a vast array of characters and family members in the town and so forth. So to get started, that requires workshop protocol number 2. Again, that should be down in the description for the video, but I have it on my computer, so I'm just going to go right to Network Canvas and load up that particular protocol. Let's go and see. All right, so at the moment we only have the one protocol loaded. Let's go and load a different one. This is the altered demo. So if I open that up, once again, protocol installed successfully. So I go up here and we can see here that now the new protocol that we've added is going to be the new sort of most recent interview to start. We can go and select other protocols, just like we could below in selecting other interviews. All right, I'm going to click on that. I'm going to go SB demo 2001. All right, could call it anything, Simpsons demo, whatever. We'll start the interview. And so the first way in which we can add data through Network Canvas is one we've shown already before, which is quick add. Now we're going to use quick add and we're going to use per network question. So this should look kind of familiar to what you've seen in the prior demo. Let's look at that. Please add each of the five main Simpsons family members. Poor grandpa feeling a bit left out, but we're really just referring to Marge and Homer, Bart, Lisa, and Maggie. Okay, so now we're done here with them, and I can then go down to the next screen. Please neatly arrange the Simpsons characters. Now, we're once again pretty similar to what we saw before. A quick add, sociogram, lines. Who likes to watch television together? Now, I'm going to say that Marge and Homer do. I'm going to say that Bart and Lisa does. And I don't know, perhaps Homer and Bart do. Maybe they watch, you know, monster trucks or something. I think I remember that. And who likes watching Krusty the Clown? I'm going to say just Lisa and Bart like watching Krusty the Clown. So we have here this three edges, and we have these two nodal attributes. And we can see all of this on the same screen. Finally, we have here, and we didn't see this in part one, this is a categorical bin interface. Now let's have a look at each one of these. You can see when you mouse over them, it highlights them. And if I click on one, it actually kind of features this. Now, why would we want to feature it? At the moment, there's no real reason. We can click away and it just goes back to normal. But just watch what happens. What color is the shirt or dress normally worn by the Simpson character? Ooh, Homer, I believe, is white. Marge wears a green dress. Bart wears an orange shirt. Lisa wears an orange dress. And Maggie, I think, wears a blue, I don't know, baby onesie or whatever. Now imagine if I was like, no, actually, Maggie is going to wear a green dress. We can drag Maggie over to here. And then we can see that's where Maggie is. But actually, I'm going to put her back there. But that's just how you can sort of review who is in each of these, is Bart and one other, and make changes in case the respondent puts it in the wrong place and wants to correct it somehow. Okay, so that's pretty much like the interview that we saw the first time around. But now let's do it slightly differently. And let's see how it feels to do it slightly differently. So we're going to use a name generator form this time. Now, if I click on this, just watch what happens. We're going to go per alter rather than, per network for these. First, what's the name of the character? I'll start again with Homer. Homer's shirt is white. And I'll say, no, they don't like watching Krusty the Clown. Finished. Now let's do the same thing again for Marge. Marge and her dress, I believe, was green. And no, she does not like watching Krusty. That I'm confident of. I have three more to go. Bart, his shirt is orange. And of course, yes, Bart does like watching Krusty the Clown. Lisa. Lisa's dress is also orange. She likes watching Krusty the Clown. Now you'll notice down below here, I also want to point this out. See, let's get a little bit of the text here. You've got to watch this. Sometimes you can have a form that is larger than the screen size. You got to make sure that people are aware of going all the way down to the bottom of that form. It's worth testing it with your device to see if it's visible, to see if there's a mandatory question at the bottom, or other ways to guarantee that these lower questions or anything off screen isn't missed. But as a general rule, it's best to avoid having questions hidden from the respondent and expecting them to use these sorts of elements. Anyway, that's finished. One more to go, and that's Maggie. Okay, Maggie, blue. Does Maggie watch? I don't think Maggie likes that. So now we've done pretty much most of the name interpreter questions and the name generator questions in one in this case. Although I will say, to me, it felt a little slower doing it this way than it did the previous way. Now, per dyad comparisons, this is interesting. This is a different way of adding edges. Now, the last time we added edges, we put everyone on the sociogram first, and then we drew the edges between them. Now, here, let's do this kind of the other way around. Do these two characters like watching television together? Yes, they do. Homer and Bart? Yeah, I think he does. Not really. I don't think so. No, they don't watch TV together. No, they don't watch TV together. I don't know. Maybe they do. I'm not sure. Maybe we can have an unsure button. No. Marge and Maggie, I think they've watched television together. Bart and Lisa have definitely watched television together. And Bart and Maggie, I don't think they get on like that, and so forth. Now, you notice that time, that's what's called the dyad census. And that meant we were able to evaluate each and every edge pair. So that gives you a much more firm basis for establishing whether an edge exists or not than doing it on kind of free recall on the sociogram screen. On the other hand, this one does increase the respondent burden, and as the network gets larger, it really increases the burden. It tends to scale exponentially, so if you have, you know, five people in this case, you don't have that many questions to ask them. It's actually n outside of n minus 1, I believe, over 2. So that would be 10 questions we had to go through that time. But if you have 20 people, n outside of n minus 1 over 2 is going to be a lot. If you had 20, I think it's 190 questions. So, you know, we quadrupled the size of the network, and we would increase the number of questions by, a factor of 20. So, you know, we got to be careful with using the dyad census, but when you really want to be sure about all of those edges, it's available for you. Now just watch what happens here because I've already done the dyad census. Oh, look at that. That edge has already shown up. Check that out. Look at that. Now here's a different way entirely. Quick add in per alter forms. So it starts off the way that we did it before. And, you know, once again, Homer, Marge. I'll put Maggie next. Why not? Lisa, and then we'll round off with Bart. But now this time, instead of doing those name-generating questions with all that data right at the beginning, what we've done is we've split that up into two tasks. First is a quick add to get all the names out. And then once we have the names, do the questions on a per alter basis. See this? We have like Homer here. What color is the shirt? White. No, he doesn't like Krusty the Clown. Marge, green. You notice I used here, this is a different control than before. Before I used the explicit yes or no Boolean choice control. So I had to press no every time. This time I'm using this toggle button here where you toggle on and off, and it has a default state. This, of course, is much like the Boolean one on the sociogram. That's most useful when you're confident that you, like a no response and a false value, you don't mind distinguishing between them. But if you really must be sure of the difference between yes, no, and unsure, I don't know, then you should use the Boolean choice one, which requires you to have a something explicitly saying yes or no. But now let's just buzz through this again. Maggie, blue, then we have Lisa, orange, and likes Krusty. Bart, orange, and likes Krusty. We didn't show a third way to collect edges because we didn't have a third way to collect edges. But, you know, if you wanted to collect edges, of course, you could take these two right here, quick add, and then do either the ways we've done above with the dyad census and the sociogram layout, or the sociogram layout with the adding edges as a prompt on the sociogram itself. Now, one last way of adding nodes I wanted to show off here, and that is using rosters to help with recall. Now, I believe The Simpsons are pretty popular as a cartoon and widely known, but in a lot of cases, you may have a situation where you want people to recognize rather than do free recall. A classic example of this is a classroom study or a workplace study where you have the names of all the colleagues, and you want to Just get them to nominate, say, who they work with and what team or whatever, or in the class, who they get advice from or study with. That would be an example of using a roster. And so let's have a look at a roster right here. Please add all the Simpsons characters. Now you'll notice we have four here in the roster. We didn't have five. Homer seems to be missing, and we can go and investigate that later. I'll show why. But let's see now. Look at what I can do here, dragging from the side panel to the node list. Maggie and Bart. So just watch this. Now the roster disappears, but as soon as I click and hold a node, it appears as a drop zone. We also still have the trash drop zone down there, but it kind of gets out of the way to keep things nice and tidy here. So using a roster, you can also nominate people as well. Now this finishes this second protocol, but I did want to show a couple features under the hood in Architect before we conclude the entire walkthrough. Not the least of which, I want to see why was Homer missing? Well, let's have a look. Well, it looks like the CSV here didn't have Homer on there at all. Look at that. And we can also see, if I go and double click on this, that how did we even do that? Let's have a look here. See, I added all these. And down below, Simpsons roster plus name generator. If we go in here, you can see this is actually node type 4. I can just check this out, in fact. Over here, this is the first way of doing things, and I made 5, the second way 5, third way 5, and the last one I only had 4. And we also have two different kinds of edges, it seems, that we've mapped within there. One is based on a dyad census, and one is based on the which goes for this one. And then there's the one which is the sociogram screen, which goes there. Well, the reason I did it is because I wanted to show that in this particular circumstance, please add all the Simpsons characters. We can create one here. We got Homer. Does this character like watching Krusty the Clown? And look at that, even a brand new form where before we had the nice colored circles, this time we have what's called a radio box, which allows you to just like toggle one. Whereas the colored ones, you can set the option so you can actually toggle multiple of them. So now we have them all right here. And finish that interview. So we go over here and look at that form, add the Simpsons. What's this character field? Look down the prompts. Here we had a side panel. And the side panel used SimpsonsRoster.csv, which we added in there. To find out how to do that yourself, please check out some of the other videos, particularly on working with Network Canvas Architect. So that concludes this video on the Network Canvas walkthrough. I hope this was useful for you in getting you a little more comfortable with the Network Canvas Interviewer software. To remember and to recap some important things about Network Canvas Interviewer. It's a piece of software. It runs on multiple different kinds of operating systems, both mobile and on laptops. The software itself is, open source and freely accessible. When you run it, you would load protocols. Protocols are these script files for how to conduct an interview. Each protocol can be used with multiple people or multiple cases on the same app, or if you're using server to coordinate them, you can use it on multiple different devices and have the same protocol and all feed into the one study. Once you go through your protocol itself, it's going through stages. We like to think of this as having this sort of spatial ordering from the top to the bottom. And each stage can have multiple prompts on them. The prompts can be different ways of collecting data or different approaches to looking at the data. And that will be all with the interviewer. Now you'll note it, or interviewee. Now you'll notice that you can zigzag or navigate through the stages, but we do prefer, this linear stepping through one stage after the other. When you're done, you can export the interview, and we provide two export options, GraphML, which is a single file that's relatively machine readable and useful for a variety of network analysis programs, from UCINET and PIAC to Gephi and Visoni. Or you can use export to CSV, which doesn't have the same features as GraphML, but does contain much of the same data, except it has to do it in multiple files. And that you can use with a variety of statistical programs, and either in, say, Python or in R, particularly the EgoR package, which allows you to compile and or sort of collate them and analyze multiple ego-centered things at the same time. You can see more about how to conduct or how to construct a Network Canvas protocol in our video on building or our walkthrough on using Architect. And then you can see a subsequent video walkthrough, and that's on how to do some analysis with Network Canvas data in R. And those should be available from our website, and you can see more through our channel.